Welcome to the world of wild caving in China, where there is such a great quantity and variety of caves that there is truly a little something for everyone. This program shows, through the details of just one expedition in March of 2015, that caving in China can satisfy the desires of just about any caver. Not only is there plenty of vertical caving to be had, but there is even more very nice horizontal discoveries to be found. Dry caving, sure. Wet caving, no problem. Big caves, small caves, you name it, it's there. There is tons of science that can be done in China, especially in terms of historical saltpeter mining. Plus, plenty of work on geology, hydrology, and other fields. But there is more to caving in China than just the caves. There is the culture, the people, the towns, and the geography. There is the travel, the food, and the activities one goes through in order to pursue great caving in China. Using our expedition from March, this program will show all of this, including some of the caves and caving that can be had in China. The March 2015 trip to China was a joint Chinese foreign expedition with the support and cooperation of the Wulong Karst Management Bureau and the Institute of Karst Geology. The expedition was coordinated and run by Aaron Lynch and the Hong Wai Gui Red Rose Cave Exploration Society. The purpose of the expedition was to help the Chinese government, specifically Wulong County, document cave and karst resources in the northeastern section of Wulong County.
Okay.
The expedition for this year was smaller than in years past, with a total of 7 members participating. The team included Aaron Lynch, Philip Schuhart, Sarah Fleetwood, Joe Meyer, David Saki, Becca Lawson from England, and Andrea Futrell. The flight from the U.S. to China was from Dulles Airport to Northern Virginia, over the Bering Straits, across eastern Russia, and then to Tokyo, Japan. We transferred to another jet and flew to Shanghai. Then we took an internal 4-hour flight to Chongqing. A closer look at China shows our internal flight from Shanghai to Chongqing, which gives you a general idea on our location within China. And then closer still, we took a full-size bus from Chongqing to Wulong, a 14-passenger van to Tongsa, and finally a small pickup to Jelong. But this just shows where we went. What was it really like getting to China? Well, we started out in a snowstorm in the DC area. Luckily, the storm cleared, allowing us to take off on time. The only interesting aspect of the 14-hour flight was flying over the mountains of Korak in eastern Russia, just west of the Bering Straits. This was one of the largest and most desolate mountain ranges I had ever seen. Anyone for a hike? We rode the high-speed rail in Shanghai, going 187 miles per hour. But the best was the subway in Chongqing, a 2-hour ride from the airport to the bus station. Chongqing is a huge city, home to 7 million people. Then we took a full-size bus to Wulong, a 3-hour ride. Wulong was another large city. The next day, we rode in a 14-passenger van to Tongsa, a 4-hour drive. On the way, we drove through a local funeral procession, very different than what you would see in the U.S. They really liked fireworks in China. This is Tongsa, the base of operations in Wulong County for many cave expeditions, and home to Aaron's karst center.
Tongsa. You're in Tongsa.
Within walking distance of Tongsa is Trash Cave.
Oh my God. Oh jeez. This is just on the outskirts of Tongsa.
The locals have been dumping their trash down a chute into this karst window for years. The trash nearly covers the downstream and upstream entrances to this multi-mile cave system. It was pretty disgusting.
That's the actual entrance down there, the downstream entrance?
That's the downstream, that's the upstream.
Wow.
Meanwhile, back to our travels. The next day, we loaded up a little pickup truck with all our clothes, food, water, and caving gear, which included lots of rope and vertical stuff.
And the really big black bag.
We had so much that Aaron nearly got trapped in the back of the truck. The drive from Tongsa to Jalong was in the rain, but through some really cool karst. It took about an hour. We stayed at this motel, which was actually pretty nice for China.
Jalong Caving Center.
Rental included the use of this expedition room.
Jalong, looking for lunch.
Jalong is a small farming town with a population of about 300 people. There is only one street and is a pleasant mixture of the old and the new. There was only one restaurant in town. We went caving every day for 13 straight days. Here's what we did every day. Breakfast at 7 a.m. Just kidding. Here is what we really had most mornings. Hike to the cave for 1 to 2 hours. Cave for 6 to 7 hours in a variety of caves. Hike back from the cave. Eat dinner in Jalong. Do data reduction, draft maps, and sort photos. Sleep for 6 hours. Repeat 12 times. No matter what your skill level is, or what your interests are, you need to get to the cave or area of interest. On this expedition, we found that getting to the caves in China mostly involved walking. We had to go over various and assorted types of terrain, but a good portion was over brand new concrete roads. One of our routes involved walking through a tunnel, which was built by the locals and connects Jalong and the Dolan to the west. Sometimes we hitchhiked, which was not a problem at all in this part of China. The Chinese used lots of concrete, even to the point of turning their paths into sidewalks. A number of times, we'd go through houses and basements. When someone was home, we stopped to say hello. We would go down steps into beautiful karst valleys, down dirt roads, and through fields of all kinds. And sometimes we had to bushwhack through jungle and up steep karst towers.
Very steep.
Not every local was a person who could lead us to a cave. We passed by a number of interesting people, people who found us just as interesting as we found them. In some cases, we saw that the range of technology was very large in China. From manually plowing the fields with oxen to using cell phones, even at the cave. And it wasn't just interesting people we saw on our way to the caves, but animals too. Cows on the road, angry geese, cute goats, noisy pigs, and of course, chickens in a bag. But when the mix of cavers and locals was right for a certain amount of communications, we always had an interesting conversation, sometimes useful and sometimes not.
每次来广告，就把那个水拉出来呀，拿个水拉出来呀，买好多钱呢。差不多，OK。好，我们住在大凤洞。
大凤洞啊，孩子要去大凤洞啊。
大凤洞。
Sometimes you get to talk to the whole family, including multiple generations. In this case, Erin was along, which was good because she understood most of what was being said. In some cases, we tried to get the local to write down the name of the cave. The written language is a lot less ambiguous than the spoken word. There are so many dialects that sometimes even our best could not understand what was being said. In a number of cases, the locals were kind enough to guide us right to the cave. In this case, the farmer insisted on bringing his cow. He did lead us to a cave, although it was quite small. In this case, we were looking for Pengong Wandong, a new saltpeter cave. We had Erin along on this day, plus our guide was a little better educated than some of the other locals we met. In this case, our guide knew exactly where the cave was. Other times, people would stop just to say hello, which gave us plenty of opportunities to ask about caves. More likely than not, they would know where a new cave was. After some discussion, this young Chinese man offered to take us to a cave he knew about. We even got to ride in the back of his truck. And then he led us through fields and up hills for a half mile, right to the entrance. Good. Another new cave. The best experience we had, though, was when one of the local farmers invited us to dinner after a particularly long day of caving. Social hour was sitting around the fire in their living room, chatting about world affairs. Then we moved to the dining room, where the whole family gathered and helped prepare dinner.
It's mine, yeah, but somebody can wear it.
The whole family pitched in. Some of the home decorations were quite interesting. Finally, dinner was served. It was actually quite a feast, but mostly vegetables and rice, very much like dinner in Geelong. It's hard to not make a mess when using chopsticks. So, what about caving in China? Well, as it turns out, just like anywhere else, there is a little something for everyone. There is vertical caving, easy and hard. There is horizontal caving, large and small. Yes, in China, this is considered small. There is documentation, exploration, science, history, and saltpeter. You can find wet caving or dry caving. One thing you can find for sure in China is lots of caving. Finding new caves is one of the more exciting aspects to caving in China, and there are plenty of new caves to be found. Discovering new caves can be done by anyone and everyone, regardless of your skill set in caving. On this particular expedition, we did a lot of searching for new caves, and in most cases, we were very successful. Finding Phung Dong was by far the most exciting. Becca and I discovered this cave on the first day of our expedition, and we didn't even have the help of locals. The system turned out to be 4 kilometers long and 103 meters deep. We spent 7 days with 16 different trips to finish both the horizontal and vertical sections of this cave. In this case, the local resident led us down dirt roads, through fields, and hacked a path to show us Pengong Wandong, an especially fine saltpeter cave. Even though it is not virgin, we didn't have time to finish the cave, so we don't really know the true extent of this fine horizontal cave. Even the locals don't know how far the cave goes. Dai Dong Hai was another cave we didn't need any help finding. We could see it for miles and were able to bushwhack up to the entrance with no trouble at all. It was a real thrill to find this huge entrance, even though the cave turned out to be short. Tian Min Dong was found with the help of a local farmer and friend. They used machetes to hack away up a steep mountainside to find a large entrance. Again, we had the thrill of finding a large cave with all the trappings, beautiful formations, nitrate works, and a 30-meter pit leading to Big Trunk Passage. On our last day of caving, we were headed to work on Pengong Wandong when we ran into some locals on the dirt road who told us about a cave down by the river. We couldn't resist, so Becca and I followed them to a medium-sized entrance to a saltpeter cave. We ended up exploring and documenting all day and still didn't finish. A dry crawl led to more cave, and as can be seen from the map, we turned around in going large cave. If you like doing vertical work, there is plenty of that in the caves of China. And the only way to find virgin cave is by doing vertical. The Chinese have pretty much explored everything that is easily accessible, but they have not and do not do vertical. On our very first day of caving in Phung Dong, as we explored downstream, we were stopped by a double set of 5-meter waterfalls. This traverse line was installed in order to allow us to drop into the lower canyon without getting soaked. It also allowed access to a whole new section of the cave, just on the far side of the traverse. Phung Dong, the longest new cave we documented, is 4 kilometers. Over half of it was virgin because of the vertical work that was required. There was the upstream section, which was reached via a 5-meter bolt climb, and then the downstream section, which was accessed via the traverse and a 10-meter drop. T Street Canyon is just one small part of the virgin cave explored on the other side of the downstream traverse. Access to T Street was via an easy crawl that stretched a full 27 meters.
This was a 27-meter long tunnel here.
The easy crawl led to a high, narrow canyon, which was windy, wet, and cold. Stemming up and down these narrow canyons was a challenge. One end of T Street ended in a too narrow crack that looked to lead to a pit, while the other side ended with a high lead where the water was coming down from the 27-meter high ceiling.
27 meters high ceiling. The water is dripping in from here. This is a deep 40. It's all because it's foggy in here and it's cold in here. That's the crack that leads to the pit.
In Gai Dong, a previously explored cave, Philip installed a traverse which gave us access to a large virgin side lead. Joe and I explored and documented the side lead, while Philip and Sarah dropped the 30-meter pit to explore the lower levels. Some of the most beautiful passage we found in China was on the other side of the traverse in Gaidong.
So off the main passage, a lot of these side passages, like the one we're in, run north-south. Philip and I noticed that yesterday when we were looking around surveying. So we might be in another one of the fault control passages here. This is all virgin, previously untouched, and it's absolutely beautiful.
Oh, nice.
At the end of this large trunk passage, we found an especially interesting calcite column that had been etched out on one side from what must have been very corrosive water.
Yeah, that's cool.
It's a flowstone that's being eroded.
Okay.
Carved out this big chunk, you can see right there that face is the internal. There's this weathered shell.
Uh huh.
But on the inside is all this nice calcite.
Yeah.
And you can follow the growth rings.
Uh huh.
And you can see the curvature of the mound.
Yeah.
There.
Oh, yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
In a newly found cave, Tian Min Dong, we were stopped from proceeding by a 30 meter pit.
Down here on the left is a pit
with air.
With air in it.
The way down was really enticing because of the huge echo.
You can hear the echo?
So the next day, Becca and I rigged the drop in order to explore the virgin cave below. In this case, a traverse line around the edge of the pit was required because of loose rocks. The traverse led to a Y-hang over the top of the pit in order to avoid the lip.
Captured forever on video.
The bottom of the 30-meter pit in Tian Min Dong revealed some very large trunk.
Actually, that's pretty cool. You can hear the echo. Unfortunately, this is the end of our trunk passage in Sky Cave.
For those not vertically inclined, there is a ton of horizontal cave in China. Of the 14 caves we found on our expedition, only three of them required vertical work. The rest were horizontal. Feng Dong is a good example, with an easy horizontal entrance leading to large passage. Feng Dong had a large variety of passage types, from windy and wet tall canyons with a beautiful waterfall to a very dry, small climb down that led to some nice walking passage, the porcupine section. This even led to another entrance, found from the inside.
Yeah. So Philip and Sarah heading into the entrance to Gaidong.
Do you want easy, humongous passage where your light is sucked up into the fog of an inner atmosphere? Then Gaidong is a cave to visit.
It's really foggy in here.
In places, it is hard to even find the walls.
Here is a wall. There's Joe. And then over here someplace is a wall, maybe. Up there, okay.
Not all of Gaidong is huge. There are sections where the passage is quite comfortable and very easy to traverse.
That's good.
Gaidong High was not as large as Gaidong, but it was a new cave and had some very respectable sized passage and was a real joy to explore and document. It also had a large entrance room with bright green moss which literally glowed in the afternoon sun.
That is really nice.
For comfortable, dry, pleasant passage, Jingdong Min was a real pleasure and very nice to investigate. The same was true with Zaidong, which had plenty of nice sized walking passage. Then there was Pengong Wandong, with its maze of interconnected levels with nice rooms, distinctive bedding, and interesting geological features. If you want to do a little more than documentation all the time, there is so much history surrounding the caves of China, especially in regards to saltpeter works. A good 60% of the caves we explored had been worked for saltpeter. One of the best sites for saltpeter works was Pengong Wandong, the very dry and multi-level cave that had three documentation trips. The saltpeter vats here are particularly well preserved.
So we've got a really nice example of a nitrate pit here. So this is the upper pit that they filled with water and then let stuff leach out of, I think. And you can see the wall, and then they've lined it with earth. And then if we come around here, we can see the wall falling down, and there's a smaller, lower pit, which would have taken the leachate. And you can see what would have had a little tiny bamboo pipe, I think, pulling through to let the water gradually kind of settle out. So I'm not really sure about the process, but...
Jingdong Men had a nice nitrate pot along with a finely preserved fire pit.
It's discolored from the fire.
Yeah.
Like that is orangey colors.
That is nice. That's a good.
Saltpeter vats and pots are not the only things to be found of historical interest. Feng Dong had some cool Chinese writing in the mud on the way to the porcupine section. Pengong Wandong also had Chinese writing.
There is a rock with Chinese writing on it.
Jingdong Men had tally marks and fine samples of Chinese writing on the ceiling and walls of a fairly low crawlway.
That's good. That's good, good Chinese writing there.
Zidong had large rock walls built up in sections of the main passage.
Wow. Why did they do that?
Well, sometimes they do it to stop the drought.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And Zidong, which means nitrate cave, was unusual in other ways too. The entrance was totally walled up for some reason. But the local who took us to the cave had no problem at all in taking down the wall so we could all go exploring.
Yeah, because.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a big rock.
We're not gonna put this back.
No. Good.
Wow.
The back end of Zidong also had some unusual rock structures built inside. It looked like they built rock columns to support a huge boulder as they mined underneath.
That is really cool. Yeah.
From what little information we could get from the locals, they don't really know what these structures were for. They could only say that saltpeter mining did take place in the cave. By now, it should be obvious that caving in China is not just for the super strong, gung-ho vertical caver. There is such a variety of caving available in China that there is really a little something for everyone.